morning. You weren't here last night. Okay, great. Well, I'm glad you guys made it out. I would definitely say that you want to get the CD or the tape or the video or whatever you can get a hold of, because I'm building progressively on each time that I speak. So those who come tonight, they are going to have a lot of things that they've missed so far. And I'm really glad you guys are coming back consistently, because we're just going to keep building. So with that, last night, briefly, we covered how the Lord has been restoring the 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit to the body of Christ. I kind of went through a timeline of the last 100 years. I brought us up to the point where the Lord's currently working on discerning of spirits. He's teaching the body of Christ what it is, what it means, how to operate in it. I talked about how we, as human beings, are 3 parts, that we're spirit, soul, and body. The soul being commonly accepted as the mind, the will, and the emotions. Now, another thing I covered that I kind of jumped ahead a little bit is I covered the fact that we have 5 senses in each of our 3 parts. You're a 3-part being, and you have 15 senses. It gets a little complicated, but essentially you have 5 senses: taste, touch, sight, sound, and smell, in all 3 compartments of who you are. You remember this? Good. Okay. I know it was a late night, so. Well, what I want to go from there is I want to explain how the spirit realm works and how we interact with it as spirit beings. Now, how many of you, we'll just test your discernment right here. What does this look like to you? A what? We have a cookie. We have a pie. We have a button. To me, this is a disappointing pepperoni pizza. Gotta warm you guys up a little bit. Fun class. All right. What we have here in this bullseye really helps us understand why it says it's the gift of discerning of spirit. Remember I said last night, it's plural. It's not the gift of discerning Holy Spirit, just one spirit. Discerning of spirit. I divide this up into 4 categories of spirits that we can discern. And I just gave you the clue of the Holy Spirit. That's the first. If you're taking notes, you're going to want to draw the same bullseye, and in 1 quarter of it, you have the Holy Spirit. Now, in another quarter, I'm going to have you put heavenly spirit. The reason that I use the word heavenly spirit rather than angelic is because there are many different categories. You have cherubim, seraphim, the 4 living creatures, the spirit of wisdom and understanding and counsel and might and knowledge and fear of the Lord in Isaiah 11. So when I say heavenly spirits, I mean non-fallen beings that are not the Holy Spirit. So it's kind of an umbrella term. Now our next umbrella term is going to be the demonic spirit. That is another umbrella term, because we know Ephesians 6 talks about powers and principalities and rulers, and we have archangels, and we have fallen angels and demons, and another umbrella term, the demonic. That's what I mean when I say that. Now, it leaves us with 1 section here, and this is the human spirit. Okay. You have 4 types of spirits that live and dwell in the spirit realm that you can interact with when you begin to operate in the discerning of spirit. Follow me so far? Okay. So what we have to understand about this, I meet a lot of people who, when they operate in discerning of spirits, the only thing they pick up on is dark and negative. Now let's look together here. Holy Spirit, good or bad? Heavenly spirits, good or bad? Demonic spirits, good or bad? Hey, you guys, you should get a seminary degree just for having that figured out. Most seminaries, you get confused with some of this. Human spirit. But Okay, we'll clarify. We'll get there. All right, well, let's just jump off that last point. So you have 25% is Holy Spirit, and that's good. And then you have another 25%, and that is Heavenly Spirit, also good. So far, we know that at least 50% of your discernment should be good. At least 50%. We also know demonic spirits, another 25%, that's going to be bad. Bad. Okay. Human spirit. This is where it gets interesting. Okay, so write this down if you have it so far, because I'm going to erase the board and I'm going to move to another illustration. But get your pie written out there. What we really need to get a hold of, and this has been a massive confusion in the body of Christ, is about the human spirit. You remember last night, I touched on some things about how we see ourselves and how we've really taken some old covenant stuff out of context, applied it to ourselves, and end up with a horrible view of ourselves, and we call it humility. Well, it's important that we get some of these figured out, because currently, you've probably heard this phrase, people say, well, I just don't want to say that to that person because it'll give them a big head. You've heard the phrase, like, if I compliment them, if I tell them how amazing they are, I might give them a big head. Well, that's not your concern. It's never your concern whether what they do with the edification you give them. The Bible says to edify, to encourage, to love, to build up, to strengthen, to... It's your job to give. It's their job to handle it. Yeah, they could take it, they could do something wrong with it, but that's between them and the Lord. It's your job to give. So, we have to understand this human spirit thing, because a lot of us, either we view the human spirit negatively in ourselves, but also in others. And so we don't know, how do I interact with a human spirit? We see it as, well, I'll lay it out for you. Here's the next illustration. We're going to draw three circles. Now, mine look a little more like Fabergé eggs, but it works. I'll probably redraw this one. My wife has a degree in fine arts, and I draw circles. Incompetent circles. All right, in your first circle, you're going to write spirit. The second is going to be soul, and the third will be body. Now, this is you. This is every one of you, every one of everyone you know has a body, a soul, and a spirit. Now, when we look at this, and we read, and I'll just read it to you in Hebrews 4:12, a common, well-known verse. It says, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit. Joints and marrow, it judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Well, we're zeroing in on the word of God is a double-edged sword. It divides soul and spirit. Now, here's the way that a lot of people understand that verse. They see the word of God as a sword that divides soul and spirit. When we read it, that's kind of how we see it. That's what we think we're reading. Part of the reason we think we're reading that has been because there's been a teaching in the church. How many of you have heard of or read The Spiritual Man by Watchman Nee? Yeah, that's quite a number. That has been a monumental book in the body of Christ. It's 700 pages. It's volume 1, 2, and 3, and it's translated from the Chinese in the 1930s. I mean, you're talking, this is a bear of a book to really get through. And one of the things he taught in there was that this sword divides the soul from the spirit. Now, on the surface, that doesn't seem to cause a problem until you start to work out the implications of it. The implications being, under Watchman Nee's explanation, he would say that the soul and the body comprise what's called the flesh. He would say, this is the flesh. He would say, the spirit is the spirit. So now, when you have in Galatians 5 a war between flesh and spirit, he's saying the war is actually a war inside yourself, where your body and soul are fighting on the carnal evil side versus your spirit, which is good. Now, this doctrine is called the perfect spirit doctrine. The idea being that when you got saved, the Holy Spirit entered your spirit and perfected it, and now you have to work the perfection out through the rest of you. That's a perfect spirit doctrine. What this comes from, it's actually something in the first century there was a group of people called the Gnostics. The Gnostics believed that the spirit was good and the soul and the body were evil. They had so infiltrated the church in the first century that a third of the church was swept into Gnostic thought. That's why 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John were written, was to counter Gnostic thought. That's why in 1 John he says, Jesus Christ, whom we've touched, whom we've seen with our own eyes. He's saying to them, guys, Jesus, we interacted with him physically. So the Gnostics were saying this, if the spirit's good, the soul and the body are bad, Jesus must not have come as an actual flesh being. He must have come as an ethereal ghost and floated around on the earth for 33 years. Well, you don't really have the shed blood of Jesus Christ if he's just a ghost. It was a cult. Gnosticism was a cult. That's why he writes to them and he says, those who say that Jesus Christ did not come in the flesh are antichrist. The antichrist was the Gnostic teaching of the first century. You know, the Antichrist is not listed in the book of Revelation. It's only listed twice in 1 John and twice in 2 John. And it's always in the context of this thought. He's rebuking Gnostic thinking. The Gnostic thinking saying the soul and the body are bad. Jesus must have come as a ghost. And if he came as a ghost, he couldn't have really shed his blood. There is no redemption of sins. That's a big problem. You're not a Christian if you believe that. So, interestingly enough, a lot of the modern New Agers actually call themselves Gnostic Christian. They believe in Jesus as a ghost, but not as a human, not as the Son of God, not as one who shed blood for our sins. So, part of the issue here is that that Gnostic thinking has crept into the church, and it was really, it infiltrated the American church strongly, very strongly, through the spiritual man. Now, Watchman Nee is not a Gnostic, but he was influenced by some of this thinking. Now, even the monks all throughout the Dark Ages, you see, are influenced by this thinking. Remember the self-flagellation. When they would sin, they would whip themselves, they'd beat themselves. It was a putting the flesh under. The problem is they have a misunderstanding of what is the flesh. The flesh is not your soul and your body. That is a wrong description of the flesh nature. What happens here, the reason that they say that the spirit, when the Holy Spirit enters your spirit becomes perfected, is because they took one verse out of context. In Hebrews chapter 12, remember Hebrews chapter 11, we call it the Hall of Faith, right? You just have all these amazing stories of the Old Testament saints, and by the time you get to chapter 12, it says, now we have come to Mount Zion to the spirits of righteous men made perfect. That's where the perfect spirit doctrine comes from. We've come to Mount Zion, the spirits of righteous men made perfect. The problem is that verse is referring to everybody in the chapter before, chapter 11. It's referring to people who've died and are in heaven. They have perfect spirit. Do you follow me? Another issue is that in 1 Corinthians 7:1, it says to cleanse yourself of the defilement of the flesh and the spirit. Ooh. Your spirit can still be defiled as a believer. Interesting. That causes a real problem with this concept, that your spirit is perfect, holy, and always perfect and holy. Okay. Now, one of the other things, as you read Hebrews 4:12, and you might want to flip there and underline this, is it says, even to dividing soul and spirit. See, the issue here is that it has not divided both. It has actually replaced the word and with the word from. To read Hebrews 4:12 this way is to say that he divides the soul from the spirit. But that's not what the verse says. The verse actually says that the sword cuts through, dividing soul and spirit. Both have been divided. Now, when you see this, you see that everything below the sword is flesh. Everything above the sword is spirit. Now you have a real war going on. See, Galatians 5 doesn't make any sense if you define soul and body as the flesh and put them in a war against your perfect spirit. If you really think about it, how in the world, if the Holy Spirit dwells inside your spirit and has made it completely perfect, how in the world can two-thirds of who you are actually resist that? It's really not, that doesn't make sense. I mean, a lot of people think that there's an equal playing ground between God and the devil, when in reality, it's like me versus an ant. It's really not an issue, right? It's like, crush, done. But in this case, the other thing that comes out of the understanding of the sword being the wrong direction, if the soul and the body are what you're in battle against for the rest of your life, one, either you'll never get rid of your body, so you'll never win this battle, or you'll never get rid of your soul, so you'll never win this battle, there's really no progression. You cannot get rid of two-thirds of who you are to then be a good Christian. There's no end goal here. It's ridiculous. And then you start getting into these concepts where people say things are soulish. First of all, get a concordance out. Look up the word soulish. It's not there. It'll be next to, like, you know, stereo speakers. Like, it's not in the Bible. We created this word out of thin air. Soulish. The word soulish comes in because we have a negative perspective towards the soul. We go, oh, well, that's of the soul. You heard people say that's soul power, or that's a soulish prophetic word. You've heard these things, that spirit is good, soul negative. We give it a negative connotation. Part of the problem that happens when you give it a negative connotation is that we stop understanding God's value for these things. For example, all throughout Psalms, bless the Lord, O my soul. If the soul and the flesh are the same, how is your flesh going to bless the Lord? He says to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength. Spirit's not on the list, but soul is. Taking another step further, he says of the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. But I thought the body was a part of the flesh. Got a problem there, right? Temple of the Holy Spirit is not the same as the flesh. There's an issue. Now, you're starting to see some of the implications here. We have had a really negative view of, it's my soul. I got to walk in my spirit. I got to I got to bless my spirit. I got to do everything from my spirit because my soul is tarnished. My soul is messed up, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Even Paul goes so far, he says that exercise profits a little. If the body were part of the flesh, he'd say exercise profits not at all. Worthless. But he says it profits a little. And think of it this way, okay? If you were to divide it up, you have here two compartments in each one of these three. You have the compartment above, the compartment below. The compartment above is the spirit side. It's warring against the compartment below, the flesh side. Follow me so far. Here, you run 6 miles, you exercise, it's good. You build up this compartment on the body side. Here, you eat the whole box of Krispy Kreme. Not good. Soul side, you read some books, you build yourself up, you build in knowledge, you build in emotion, you learn about good communication, you spend time with friends, you edify each other, all very positive soul side. Negative side, you know, you sit down and you watch the whole marathon on TV, you know, 3 days and you're not getting up, you're just feeding as much garbage as you can, you're packing it in there. That's this side. Be practical. Spirit side. This side, you speak in tongues. You edify your spirit, right? You know that. There are other ways to edify your spirit. Fasting is another one. Mutual edification, it says in Romans, builds up each other's faith. That's another way. Prophecy builds you up as well. So you have the spirit side. You can build things up. On the negative side of the spirit, when we do deliverance, that's where the issues are. They're clinging on to the spirit side on the below the sword. The thing about this is this sword moves. As you walk out your life in Christ, your compartment here should be building all the time. This compartment should be shrinking all the time. It's really interesting. You hear people talk about, you know, that person, Sister so-and-so, they got up and then worship and they were just dancing and it was just soulish or it was fleshly. Interesting thing about that. We read Galatians 5 and it's bizarre what we in the modern church call fleshly. You know, we look at something and we go, well, it's, you know, he ran around the church in the flesh. That was just excitement. Okay, the acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. No. We have a absolutely confused understanding when we see someone get up and they dance and we act in some sort of unbelievable judgment, and we reject them, and we step way outside of love and say, that person was just blah, blah, blah in the flesh. Really? Were they having an orgy in front of everyone? Come on, let's get real. That's not on the list. We call so much stuff flesh that is not. It is nonsense to call the things flesh that we call flesh. Flesh is, he says, the deeds of the flesh are obvious. Somehow we lost track of the obvious. Real obvious flesh sin is flesh sin. But we're not talking about that when we see someone who, they make a choice with their soul, with their will and their mind and their heart to get up and do something with their body, and they're doing something to glorify God, and you know, maybe it's not coming from their spirit, but it's come from their heart, their mind, their emotions. They're loving the Lord their God with all their heart, their soul, their mind, their strength. And who are we to then go, well, that's their flesh? No, come on, the flesh, envy, orgies, debauchery, drunkenness, that's flesh. Most of us have never seen the flesh. According to that list. That felt good. But looking at this list here, looking at the new division, this clears up a lot of confusion. Another thing that's interesting is that if the soul and the body were evil, if the soul is the flesh, you would not have one in the Garden of Eden. You wouldn't have had a soul before the fall. Before the fall of sin, they did not have a flesh nature. But they did have a soul. Now, in Christ, your flesh nature was crucified. That should have been an amen. Some of us still wonder if that's true or not. That's true. That is gospel truth. That, you know, 2 Corinthians 5 lays it out very clearly that in him we were crucified. Paul says in Galatians 2:20, I was crucified in Christ, I no longer live, right? We know these verses, but the reality is the flesh was crucified in Christ. Done, deal. Dead, done, done. Part of the issue, though, is we're looking at it going, am I still trying to kill the flesh, right? Am I trying to kill it? Am I trying to remove it? What am I doing here? It's a really good question. I spent months looking up every verse I could find. Crucified, dead, buried, the cross, the flesh, the carnal nature, the old man. I looked up every one of these to see what is going on with this. Here's what I found. The flesh, it says in Colossians 2, it says the flesh was circumcised from your heart. It was cut off and thrown away. It says in Romans 6 that in Christ the flesh was removed as in baptism. Now let me ask you, there's a big question between whether the flesh being put off was an event that happened in the past through Christ, or whether it's a process that we're going through. We're struck between these two ideas. Is it an event? Is it a process? How many of you would say event? Did nobody raise their hand? Okay. How many of you would say process? Now, a lot of you are going to say both, right? You put your hand up if you're going to say both. No, nobody's going to say both now. Okay, all right, we got a couple takers. Okay, you're brave. All right. So a lot of people, nobody here believes it's a past event. A couple people will think it's both an event and a process, and most of you are saying you're on the side of saying it's process. Now, let me clearly define this for you. Water baptism, is it an event or a process? If it were a process, it would be better named a drowning. It is an event. You dunk them and they're out and you did it. Done. Jesus writes in Romans 6 through Paul that the flesh being put off, being dead in Christ, is an event similar to baptism. Let me ask you a question. Circumcision, event or process? Thank you. Oh, my Lord. It's an event. It's also another picture of how the flesh has been put off through Christ's work on the cross. Event. Now, we have something interesting, though, because although we have an ongoing something between us and the flesh, we also know that he's saying he did all the work. He's saying he put it off. He's saying that it was like circumcision. He's saying it's like baptism. It's behind you. It's done. But then how do I war with the flesh? How am I in this struggle? What's the battle here? Okay, Galatians 5 again. We read the acts of the flesh, and then it goes into the fruit of the Spirit, and it finishes out in verse 23, gentleness and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Okay, past tense. It's done. Have. It's already happened. Now, the thing is, the flesh nature has already been killed and removed. That doesn't mean the deeds of the flesh have been. You do not have two natures within you at war. That is a false doctrine. There's a false doctrine in the church called dualism that says that you have both the nature of Christ, because he says you've been made partakers of the divine nature, while on the other side, you still have a flesh nature, and these two are at war with one another. That is a false doctrine. The reason that's a false doctrine is because people have glossed over the issue that your flesh nature has been killed and removed from you. You have one nature. Think of it this way. There's a book that we know well in America. It's called Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, right? The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Here's what's going on. As a non-Christian, you were like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. You had two things going on here. You had a side of you that wanted to do right, but had no power to do right, and you had a side that didn't want to do right and did whatever it wanted to. This is the Roman 7 man. This is the person that is just struggling back and forth. That is a non-Christian. You know, a lot of us as Christians, we've sat in the church so long that we think that non-Christians are like conscienceless beings that just want to go out and sin and do their own thing, and they have no desire to do good. That's not true. Maybe you need to hang out with a non-Christian once in a while. That is not true. They just are powerless to do good because they don't have the Holy Spirit. They want to, but they can't consistently walk in righteousness. It's just not possible. In some of the other faiths, for example, in Islam, they call jihad a holy war. We, as Westerners, because of the media and because of fundamental extremist terrorists, have hijacked the term. But to a majority of Muslims, jihad actually means a holy war that's a struggle within them against sin. When they talk about killing the infidel, they're talking about killing the old nature, the way that a Christian would say they need to kill the flesh. They're saying, I'm in a holy war against the infidel within me. They are describing Romans 7 to a T. And we have over a billion of them that are stuck in that Romans 7. They've not come to the freedom of Romans 8 that we have. Now, part of the issue is if we understand this, you as a non-Christian have Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde going on in your heart all the time, okay? Then Christ comes along and he crucifies you in him. What he does is he takes Mr. Hyde to the cross and he nails him up there with him and he kills Mr. Hyde. Now, you go into your house again, you're just Dr. Jekyll. You're just a partaker of the divine nature. There's only one nature now. There's only you, Dr. Jekyll, living in this house. And you open your closet and you go, look at all of Mr. Hyde's clothes that are here. He must be in the house somewhere. I have to go find him and crucify him. I have to hunt him down and he has to die daily. I have to go find him, and we play hide and seek with ourselves for the rest of our lives, looking for someone that's not there. His stuff is still in the house, and that's why the rest of Scripture talks about put off and rid. Put off and rid. He's not saying to get rid of the nature of Mr. Hyde. Do not go and find the flesh and crucify it. He's saying put off the deed of your flesh. The flesh nature was already removed. You're not in a battle between a spirit nature and a flesh nature. You're in a battle between your spirit nature is the one nature you have, and it's working to put off and rid the old deed of Mr. Hyde. Your job now, literally, as a partaker of the divine nature, is to go into the house, grab everything in the closet, take it out in the yard, and throw it in a pile, throw a gallon of gas on it, and burn that stuff. That is your job at this point. You don't have to deal with a fallen, thin flesh nature. Christ did that. You can't do that. You can't do it. That's why Christ did it. But now he's given you the Spirit, the power. It says in Titus chapter 2 that by grace he's given us self-control and the ability to say no to ungodliness. Now we get to go, oh, that's not mine. That's Mr. Hyde. I'm going to take that out and I'm throwing it away. That's your job now. See the difference here of what's going on? You're not trying to hunt down your sin nature. You're not trying to hunt down your flesh that he already dealt with. Most of us are sinning by faith. We believe we have a sin nature. We believe we're in a struggle with it. We believe he's in the house. We believe we won't have victory. We believe that our flesh is our soul and our body, so we have an inner struggle going on for the rest of our lives till we have no body and soul. You're never going to win. You will never find victory in that kind of approach because it's based on a completely messed up foundation. It is not what's going on inside of you. The reality is you have one nature now, the partaker of the divine nature. At this point, your job is so summed up in this verse, Philippians 3:16. He says, let us live up to all that we've attained. That's incredible. He's saying, look, Jesus already gave you all this stuff. Let's try to walk in it. How about we try that? How about we try to walk in it? You know, if we're still trying to kill someone who's not even there anymore, how will we ever get to, like, put on the gift of righteousness? How will we reign in life, as Romans 5:17? How are we going to be filled with the fullness of the Godhead, as it says that we are, if we still think we're trying to kill this sucker? Not going to happen. We have to break through some of this stuff. Here's what we'll do. We're going to go back to this previous analogy here, our previous illustration that has our circle with a bullseye. Now, I'm just going to fill in the one we were talking about, the human spirit here. Human spirit. Now, the issue was, is the human spirit good? Is it bad? Now, we already covered this issue to a certain degree because we know we're not believing the perfect spirit doctrine. Okay. It can be defiled. That does happen. We're also not contrasting this and saying, well, human spirit good, human soul bad. We're not doing that anymore. We realize that's not right. So what you have going on here is really more of a division right through it, because you could have part of the human spirit that's above the sword and part that's below. Follow? When you connect it to the previous illustration with the three circles, half of this can be below and half can be above. So coming back to our statistics of 25% of what you discern is the Holy Spirit, 25% is heavenly spirits, 25% is demonic spirits, and 25% human spirit, that 25%, let's say that we divide it in half as 12.5 that can be on the positive and 12.5 that can be on the negative. Just as a general rule of thumb. You can have some above the sword, some below the sword. With that in mind, it means that your discernment should be positive 66% of the time. Those who are constantly only seeing the negative, they have a problem. Now, we can't just say, well, you just have a problem. Part of the issue comes in because maybe they're only discerning certain things because of generational stuff in their life that's not right, that they need healing and deliverance from. Perhaps it's because they've filled their eye gate so much with garbage and fear that that's what they're seeing. The third option is that I believe that the enemy is so against discerning of spirits being in operation that when someone's eyes begin to be open, he automatically starts pumping as much scary crash into your eyes as possible. So you're going to see more demonic activity when your eyes first open, usually, than you'll see the positive. And if he can get you out of fear to go, ah, I don't want this gift, which a lot of people do, it shuts down. If we can push through that, then we begin to start to develop and start to see the angelic and the Holy Spirit and the positive side of the human spirit. But that's a common process I run across, that a lot of people see the dark before they see the light, and it could be a personal deliverance issue, but it also, I believe, the enemy is trying to push them back, get them into fear, to keep them from moving forward. Now, as we had our three circles before, remembering what we have here, below and above, this is how discernment when operating with the human spirit can operate. For example, when you're picking up on something negative about someone's nature, you're picking up on what's below the sword. When you're prophesying over someone, you're picking up on what's above the sword in them, and you're telling them about it. You're becoming like a mirror, and you're saying, hey, this is what's above the sword in your life. Or you're picking up on something in maybe an inner healing or deliverance situation, and you're reflecting to them, look, this is what I'm picking up on. Now, there's a real caution of how we do that, because it says in 1 Corinthians 14, it talks about when an unbeliever comes in and they hear you prophesying, that you'll reveal the secrets of their heart, and they'll fall down praising God and worshiping, right? We know this passage, 1 Corinthians 14. But part of the issue is that what it's saying there, when it says the secrets of their heart will be revealed or laid bare, it actually means not just secrets, it means the treasure of their heart. It's not talking about calling out secret hidden sins. Let's say you have a drug dealer, you have a prostitute, someone who's living in really, really painful sin, walk into the room. Calling out the sin that they're living in, they're not going to fall down worshiping God. You're going to cause shame, you're going to cause guilt, you're going to cause all those things in their heart to respond. But you start to talk to that, let's say the young lady, and you say, this is who God created you to be. This is your value. You are worth dying for. You are, and you start laying in about the treasure of who they are, even though your discernment is going, red flags. You're not going to tell them about the red flags. They know about the red flags. You're going to tell them about this. You begin to speak redemptively to them. It's not that when Jesus came and found you, he said, look at you. You're such a horrible piece of garbage. You should really come and, like, be my slave. No, he said, hey, you look tired. You look weary. You know what? My yoke is easy. My burden, it's light. Come to me, you who are weary and burdened and need rest. That's his invitation. That's his first encounter with us. That's where he starts. You look super tired. How about you come over here and we'll have a relationship? He sees all this, but he talks to us like this. That's how this whole thing operates. It's not that you won't pick up on the negative. It's what you're going to do with it that's actually going to be powerful. You know, it's really easy when we see the obvious sinner and we do that. That's easy. Then you have family members. And they're Christian, and you're Christian, and Thanksgiving dinner's going on, and you're all together, and you're picking up on their below-the-sword stuff. That familiarity can cause issues. That's when you really have to make sure you stay in speaking honor mode and love mode and speaking above the sword. Honey, that's not who you are. That's not what you were created to do. It's not jumping in there and condemning. there is no condemnation, right? So we don't have that as a tool. We can't use that as a tool. It doesn't work. You cannot use condemnation. So you see this stuff and you begin to speak to it redemptively. You know, I know what you're doing may seem like a lot of fun, because Hebrews does say that sin is fun for a season, but that's not what you were designed for. You know what would be a lot more fun is if you got your heart healed and you didn't go do that anymore. And you were a whole, solid, healthy person. That'd be a lot better than what you're telling me you're doing. Right? And people don't reject that kind of way that we speak to them. I've said this before. I don't believe that God has ever created any atheist. But I believe the church has created. I believe that God should have a good reputation everywhere you go. If we're his ambassadors, we represent him. You know, it's amazing to look at the story of Moses hits a rock with a stick and he doesn't get to go into the promised land. A lot of us look at it and go, well, you know, this reason or that reason. When I read that story, what I see there is that Moses, it says, was angry at the people and he struck the rock and he couldn't go in. Moses was God's representative and he made God look angry to the people when God wasn't angry. I believe that is a sin that a lot of church leadership is doing nowadays. Making God look angry when he's not. You don't get to live in the promised land of your life when you're making God look angry when he's not. Not good. We don't want to be in that place of misrepresenting him as his ambassador. At this point, he has reconciled the world to himself through Christ. I'm still trying to wrap my mind around that. That's a huge statement in 2 Corinthians 5. He's reconciled, but he doesn't have relationship, and he wants relationship. He has not been able to connect with everybody yet. Let me toss this thought out there. Think about this. It says in 1 John 2:2 that he's forgiven not only our sins, but the sins of the entire world. Did you know hell is going to be filled with people who had their sins forgiven? Hell will be filled with people who have been forgiven of their sins, but never came to receive that forgiveness. They were already forgiven on the cross, but they're still going to go to hell because they rejected the forgiveness. I'm thinking right there because now you're not just coming to beg God for forgiveness every time you sin. He's already forgiven you. You're coming to pick it up. When you come up to the altar, it's not like I cried for an hour so I got forgiveness this week. I repented good enough that he chose. He chose one time 2,000 years ago to forgive you. He's never going to choose to forgive you again. You're going to come and receive it when you fall. You're going to come and say, hey, I fell again. Thank you for your forgiveness. I receive it by faith. Not, I'm here to weep and to moan and to wail and to intercede and all this stuff to try to get forgiven or a feeling of forgiveness. This is why in Hebrews it says that he put his blood on the mercy seat in the heavenly tabernacle and he sprinkles his blood upon your conscience to cleanse you from guilt. See, in the Old Testament, they put the blood on the mercy seat, so they were technically forgiven, but it says in Hebrews that they still... The blood of bulls and goats could not remove the guilt from them. They still felt guilty even though they were forgiven. New Testament upgrade. You're not only forgiven once for all on the mercy seat in heaven, but also every time you fail and fall, when you come and you receive his forgiveness by faith, he puts his blood on your conscience to remove guilt from you. That's the main issue now. We're carrying this guilt from what we did, And we think, if I repent enough, then I'll feel forgiveness. I'll feel God forgive me. He's going, look, it's not an issue between me and you of me trying to forgive you. I forgave you. The issue now is your conscience is condemning you. Your conscience is the one beating you up, and you need some of this blood on that. That's the issue now. I think it's time for some activation. So, here's what I'd like to do. If someone can get me one of these empty chairs and bring it up here, I'll need an empty chair. That would be great. As well as, I will need a volunteer. All right, your hands are up first. I'm going to take you. Come on up here. And you guys are my participants. I have already volunteered you. You have been drafted. You can put the chair right here for me. Thank you so much. Now, what's your name? Denise. Denise, come take a seat. Thank you. I would like my lovely wife to come and help me. Karen, this is my wife. Give her a round. All right, Karen will write on the board. Denise will be our guinea pig. And she'll be just fine, as long as you're nice. So, here's what we're going to do. Now, I'm sure most of you are more familiar with prophecy than with discerning of spirits, because, as I showed last night, it's been around for some years. It's been more active in the church. So what we're going to do is we're going to activate discerning of spirits, but we're not going to activate prophecy right now. Here's how it's similar, though. If you have prophesied, you have operated in discerning of spirits. Because what you do is when you look at Denise and you begin to pray in tongues, and you're asking the Lord for a word, a vision, a picture, of scripture verse, whatever it is, when you look at her in the Spirit, you're about to start picking up by the Holy Spirit something above the sword or something below the sword. The Lord shows it to you, and then you begin to speak that prophetic word to her above the sword, and you begin to speak that to her. So if you have prophesied, you've already discerned. So, you can increase your prophetic gift tremendously by sharpening discernment. But here's how it operates. So we're gonna have you guys take a few minutes with your eyes closed and just press in and ask the Lord to show you something. And what you're asking for specifically is asking the Lord to show you something that's above the sword in Denise's life. Now, you're not going to launch into a prophecy, but you might see her leading worship, let's say. I don't know anything about you, but you might see her leading worship. You're just going to say, Denise, I see you doing this, whatever it is. Then from there, we'll put it on the list, and then we can add to it. Once you add to it and it becomes an edification, an exhortation, or a comfort, then it's a prophecy. The difference? If I say, I see you leading worship, I've only discerned something. If then I say, the Lord's going to take that worship, He's going to send you around the world, He's going to multiply you through CDs, He's going to da-da-da-da-da-da-da, then it's into the realm of prophecy. We're just going to work on discernment right now. You may pick up details about some specific things, but we're going to stay above the sword together for now, all right? Can we do that? Okay. Close your eyes. Give you a couple minutes. Press in and let the Lord speak to you. All right, just raise your hand. I'll call on you one at a time. Shout out what you have. Right here on the end. Very meticulous. Okay? Yeah? Saw a justice. Right back here by the pillar. Boy and... Boy. Front row. By the arm of the Lord. All of the word. We'll do a little bit over here now. Front row here. Elevation. Okay. A what? Time. Okay. On the end? Sir? Yes. Ah. Picture with visual. In the back here? A boat traveling around New York City, very adventurous. I'm saying this for the people. Not everybody supported. So. Oh, sir. Saw book writing. Okay. Yeah. Miss? The color purple. Okay, purple and merry-go-round. Okay, front row. We got a couple confirmations of that, it seems like. So let's do front row here. At a blackboard in a school, a dreamer. School, children, keeping up really well. Right here? Sitting in an airport, traveling, large group of people. David? Confidence. Okay. Ben? Sounds good. She's thinking, yeah, I'll take that. A green convertible. Right back here. In the green, or whatever color that is. Yeah. Saw her moving higher in a relationship. Okay. We'll get the far end here. Right here. Dancing. Of the Lord in purple, white, and gold. Sir? Goodly treasure? Treasure. Yes. Yeah. Of grade school children. Alright, we're going to stop right there. Guys, this is good stuff. This is good stuff. Alright, we're stopping right there for now. Okay. No, you just want so many more to give. Alright. That's fine. You know what you do with that is you come and you find her after this and you give her whatever you didn't get to yet. You can do that. Now what we have on the board, thank you very much, Karen. You're done. Thank you. All right. Okay, let's take a look through these together, all right? The interesting thing, some of this is going to be a word of knowledge, some of this is prophecy, and some of this is discerning of spirit. I'm going to divide it out for you so you get a better picture on it, because right now, we kind of all took our prophetic gifting and threw it at the board. And that's what we got up here. But now we'll start to sort through this and go, okay, which one of these is, here's your definition, a word of knowledge is a supernatural fact about the past or the present. If the Lord were to touch me and go, oh, you know, I have a pain in my knee that's not mine. Maybe someone here has a problem with their knee The Lord wants to heal your left knee right now. That's knowledge about your past or present. A word of wisdom would be knowledge about your future. Word of wisdom is future. It's the other side of the coin. Word of knowledge is the past and the present. So, if you look up here and we see, let's see, have you been a school teacher in the past? No. Okay. Anything teaching children? What was it? Okay. She used to do daycare, and she would work with the teacher's children. Oh, she would teach the teacher's children. Fantastic. Okay, so you have in a sea of grade school children, you have teaching, you have school children, you have these different ones over many children. You have these different children ones. Those are words of knowledge. You're picking up about a fact about her past. That's how a word of knowledge works. Word of knowledge is really something that builds people's faith, and then it's great when you link it to another prophetic word. If I walk up to a stranger on the street and I say, hey, I got a prophetic word for you, they don't know if I'm the crazy guy who walks around with a sign that says the end is near, right? When I say I got a prophetic word, they have no idea where I'm going. If I walk up with a word of knowledge, hey, you know, the Lord just showed me, you're like an amazing guitar player, right? And they're like, how did you know that? Now you've operated in a supernatural fact about their past or present that gives them confidence, gives them faith that you're onto something. You know something. You got something going on here. Then you can lead in with, and the Lord told me he wants to heal your body. And you operate in healing. Then you get them saved. You get them delivered, baptized in the Holy Spirit. You teach them to tithe. It's a wonderful day. But these are how these gifts build on each other. So, word of knowledge is a great door opener. It's really, it gives people confidence in the next thing that you're about to share. It's like the, whoa, wow, supernatural fact about the past or the present. Now, prophecy then begins to speak to the future. Now, prophecy, for example, let's see, we have prophecy. We have the arm of the Lord pulling her to another place. That's encouraging, it's edifying, it's comforting, it's something the Lord's doing in her. You have elevation, very similar. You have, you have dreamer, you have confidence. What am I looking for here? Arm of the Lord, that's prophetic. You had an experience like that? Wow. So you're picking up there on prophetic, and there's a word of knowledge. See the difference? And yet they can so intermesh. So often we want to divide these things out as if they're so different. But I mean, it really, you could walk up to someone and you could get a word of knowledge and begin to launch into a prophetic word about it, where you also mention the Lord wants to heal you. He also is gifting you in discerning spirits. And by the time 5-10 minutes goes by, you may have operated in all 9 gifts in one shot, just like that. These flow together so much. That's why this says that the gift is the Holy Spirit. The manifestations, there are 9 different ways that he manifests. The gift is the Holy Spirit. You all have the charisma gift of the Holy Spirit, but you operate in 9 different ways that he come out of you, and they can come out right on top of each other. Now, here we'll give some clear examples of discerning her human spirit. Okay, here's where you really zero in on these. Meticulous. As a real clear example of who she is as a person in her spirit, as a human that God created her. Confidence is another one. We have, let's see. Goodly treasure is an interesting one because it's something the Lord's saying about you, encouraging to you. Even though she as a person is a goodly treasure, it's really more on the prophetic side. We have joy and seeker. That's a part of who you are as a person. Those are really the main ones. We have book writing as well, which I think is prophetic, but also part of who you are as a person. It's written into your spirit. Teaching as well. I would say dreamer is in there. These can be such jumping platforms for prophecy, but you're picking up on literally a part of who she's written in her spirit, that God has created her. It says that we are his workmanship in Ephesians. The word workmanship is poema. We are God's poem. He literally writes these things into you. It's encoded in who you are. And so that's what you're reading, you're picking up on when you look at her. But these can really be jumped into different areas. So, let's see here. Who got book writing? Where was that? Okay, sir. Was the Lord showing you more about book writing? Can you launch off a little bit further into what you might be picking up on or sensing? Okay, so he first got books, and then he kept listening, and it was like books, 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 writing of books. Okay, book writing. All right, now we've gone just from just something of what's in you to that's a little more of a word there, because he's saying you're going to write them, and he's not saying it's one. He's saying it's books, 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 books. You know, it says in Ecclesiastes 12, it says, of the writing of many books, there is no end. I thought of that when I was reading and reading and reading. I was like, there is no end to this. That would be the difference right there, is that he can jump off of what he discerns and jump into a prophetic word. Let's see. Meticulous. Who had meticulous? Okay. Can you jump off of that, and what's the Lord showing you in the form of an encouraging, edifying word? Beautiful, beautiful. Says she's received that before. She's going to receive it right now as well. I added that part, but... Okay, these are great. These are great. Let me ask a different question. Not on the board here, but did anyone see something of the angelic realm when they were pressing in? Okay, ma'am, right back here. An angel dressed in white and gold, and it was up above her head as you were praying over her. And what do you sense that the Lord's saying through that? Showing you protection, or what specifically? Something like that. Guarded and protected. Okay, what I want you to see here is, yeah, we'll grab a couple more on that. What you're going to get is that, remember the circle with the four different sections? Holy Spirit, heavenly, demonic, human. Now, I said above the sword, so I'm not asking you about below the sword, which would be where demonic activity takes place. So we're not going into that. But you've picked up on the human spirit, which I've written out on the board, and now I'm asking you to pick up on that other section of the circle, the angelic or the heavenly, and we can also pick up on what the Holy Spirit's saying. Now, what the Holy Spirit's saying, we actually have that on the board too, because that's already up here. He's moving her higher in a relationship. She's going to dance before the Lord in purple, white, and gold. She's the arm of the Lord pulling her up, that there's elevation coming, that you know, there's these all these ones here that are the prophetic nature. You're picking up on what the Holy Spirit is wanting to do in her life. So, a couple more hands on the angelic. Who else? Yeah, front row here. Wow. What's your name? Ebony? Ebony, can you come up here and join me for a minute? Can you teach this class? No, come on up here. Come on up here. Oh, yes. Oh, I got it. Multiplication. All right. Well, I'd like you to stand right behind her and put a hand on her shoulder. And I'd like you to just...
I heard the Lord saying that he's coming against the, there was an angel behind you, and he was a big angel, and he had the justice weight, and I heard the Lord saying that he's going to begin to give you justice and recompense and restitution for every pain and every suffering and every situation you had to deal with in your life, that he's going to bring justice, and he's going to begin to even bring you to a house from that place of justice, and that he's going to begin to just turn everything around where you've had, like, so many times in your life, and you like, God, where do I go from here? What do I do from here? But the Lord said he's going to give you that justice, that he's going to begin to turn things around in your life.
Awesome. Good job, Mom. Go to lunch. That was good, right? Oh, boy. Well, that's how this stuff works, you guys. It's really just that simple. I'm trying to divide it up just to give you a little picture, but this stuff flows together so much. I mean, until you really get analytical and teacher-minded like I do, you're not going to notice it all, and that's okay. As long as you just can jump on it and go with it, word of knowledge, past and present. Discerning of spirits, you may pick up on the demonic, the heavenly, the Holy Spirit, or the human spirit. When you pick up on the human spirit, you can pick up on above the sword or below the sword. If you pick up on below, speak to the above. Turn it redemptive. Flip it. You know, we so often come this close to prophesying and choose not to. Because we may pray over Denise and we say, you know, the Lord, you know, we ask you, Lord, to do this and this and this and this, and we're directing it there, and he's saying, look, just direct it here. Denise, the Lord is going to do this and this and this and this. You're his ambassador. You don't always have to go beg your president from your home country to do something. You can actually take the authority he's given you and speak on his behalf to that thing, that person, that situation. She's telling me about the green convertible. I'm going to give her the mic.
I was sitting in the car getting ready to buy a new car. But after I had bought the car and I was sitting there, the Lord showed me. I was sitting in a green convertible. It was a green Jaguar dropper. And he had shown me he was going to give me this car. Told me about the car. Spoke about it. And I speak things all the time. Spirit, I said, Lord, my name is. And I pray that the intercessors will came, that they were birthed in me. By the Spirit. My leader in intercession. He told me. That's the life.
Great. That is great. Wonderful. Well, Denise, I'm going to leave this on the board. If you have a camera phone, that's the best way to come up and snap a picture of this. So, bless you, Denise. Bless you. How about we just extend, our hands and just pray for Denise here. Just bless her one more time. Lord, we thank you for her. We thank you for her willingness to volunteer and get up here. And we just thank you for all that you've said about who she is and what you're going to do. And we just agree together. We bless her. Lord, her name is Denise Ross. We agree with her, with what you want to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you got the idea. You know what's going on now. This is how you operate in discernment. Four different realms. It's a part of who you are. You operate in your five spiritual senses. And you step out and do that. Now tonight, I'm going to talk about how you activate and use your imagination. Because it says in Ephesians 1:18, it says that the eyes of your imagination would be enlightened. Your imagination is an organ of your spirit that God uses to speak to. And he speaks to you through that. And so often we go, it's just my imagination. When it's God talking to you. How often I talk to guys especially who say, you know, I just feel like it's just my imagination. And I say, now, when the enemy drops a picture of a beautiful woman in your mind, do you just go, it's just my imagination? No, you go, that's the enemy who's trying to tempt me. I see what's going on here. But when God speaks to us through our imagination, kind of ignore him. You go, it's just my imagination. We have to break through that thing. Need that imagination. It's how God is speaking to you. We can't ignore God and validate what the devil says. Just not good policy. So, we're going to talk about that tonight. We're going to get into what it means to worship in spirit and in truth as well. And you will be back here at 6 o'clock is the service. Probably one of the most interesting worship experiences that you've ever been in will be at the end of the service tonight. And I'll lead into it, and the Lord always does just an amazing thing during worship. So get a nap, get some rest, get some lunch. Thank you all. Bless you as you go, and we'll see you this evening. If there are any other administrative announcements.
Well, we thank God for the speaker. Come on, let's give him a hand. So are you enjoying this workshop? Make sure you bring a friend. Rhonda Reed. Marty Fitzpatrick and Rhonda Reed. Please see Gary Kincaid right there in the back. She's waving her hand. So we thank God. Have you enjoyed this workshop? I'm sorry. Bring a friend. Bring someone out to be a blessing also. And as you know, this is a free workshop. Our apostle has had on his heart to bring a speaker here. And we want you also to sow and be a blessing. Just bring an offering, lay it at the altar. Just sow into this, amen, and bless it. This is some good teaching. He also